Hey everyone, it's Matt. So in today's video, what I wanted to talk about is dividend investing. I wanted to make it a fairly all-encompassing video, right? So that by the time you're done with this video, you'll have a pretty good understanding of exactly what it is, what dividend investing is, how do you go about realizing the benefits associated with dividend investing, how it is a significant source of passive income, and you should be able to address all of those questions by the time you're done with this video. So one of the things that I mentioned in this introduction, right, is dividend investing is a form of generating passive income. In my mind, it's actually one of the simplest forms of generating passive income. So what exactly is passive income, right? So passive income is the opposite of active income, right? So when you go into work on a daily basis and are generating value for your employer, right, that's active income. Passive income, you basically do a little bit of legwork on the front end, right? So you buy a stock or you buy a rental property or you create a YouTube video, whatever it might be, right? And then over time, it's just gonna continue to generate some level of income for you, and dividend investing falls into that particular bucket. Now that we know what passive income is, right? So let's get a little bit further into dividend investing. But before we do that, this is a personal finance channel focused on helping you make smarter financial choices. So if that is something of interest to you, definitely hit the subscribe button, ring the notification bell as well, such that you get notified when I release future videos. So what exactly are dividends, right? So dividends is basically when a company decides that they're going to give some portion of their earnings to their shareholders. So what companies can basically do is when they generate earnings, there are three things that they can do with it. They can invest it back into the company, right? So that's in the form of research and development as an example, to generate a new product that could benefit the economy on a go-forward basis. The second thing they can do is actually buy back their own stock. That, you know, it's probably a topic for a separate video in itself in terms of the pros and cons associated with stock buybacks, but they can buy back their stock in the open market and potentially pump up their stock value as it relates to that. The third thing that they can do is issue dividends, right? And actually give dividends back to people who have invested and believe in their stock. Well, one of the key things to note here, right, is dividends in itself is becoming a bit of a dying breed. Okay, so well-established, mature companies, they continue to issue dividends and have been doing so over an extended period of time. But now with a lot of the tech companies, as an example, they're not issuing dividends, okay? So one of the things with dividends is you need to maintain a certain amount of dividend on an ongoing basis. If you don't keep maintaining that level of dividend on an ongoing basis, what happens is the stock market really penalizes you for it. So that's why a lot of companies, they don't necessarily even start on this journey of issuing dividends or declaring dividends. Now, the other thing that I mentioned is that the companies are basically making this determination that they're going to issue dividends to their shareholders. So who exactly is a shareholder? A shareholder is anybody who owns a stock in the company, right? So if you own a common stock, preferred stock, whatever it might be, as long as you own stock of that company, you're going to be eligible for those dividends. Now, let's kind of like work through it with a quick example here, right? So say there's a stock that you're very interested in buying, and say the value of that stock is $10 a share. And I'm just going to keep these numbers as simple as possible. Let's just say that the company is basically issuing dividends of $1 a share on a quarterly basis. So over 1 year, you'll basically have generated $4 in dividend income. And if you do that 4 divided by 10, that's actually a 40% dividend yield. We'll talk about dividend yields shortly here as well. So one of the key things to note, or what's so desirable about dividend investing, right, from a free cash flow perspective, is like if you think about it from this example context perspective, right, is if you're generating $4 a year and you have bought a stock for $10, after 2.5 years, right, that stock is basically free. And that's where it becomes very lucrative, right? Is because you don't start caring as much about, oh, did the stock go up, did the stock go down? You don't have to necessarily worry so much about that. What you're more interested in is, hey, I hope this company continues to pay me a dividend. And if it is one of those bellwether stocks that's been around for such a long time and is just basically a cash cow and is generating that, there's no reason to believe that that wouldn't be the case. And when it comes to these dividends, they can really accumulate over time. And, you know, a lot of people sustain their retirements just purely based on dividend income. Now, with that said, right, I know I've made a big thing about stocks so far. There's other ways of approaching dividends as well, okay? So there are ETFs, there are index funds that you can buy also such that you can get dividends from it. So these things obviously have a lot of benefits associated with them, right? So if you take the ETF or the index fund route, then you're not so much worried about having to do the research on an individual stock as an example. You buy these funds, basically, they keep spitting out a dividend, and then you can take that dividend and you can basically reinvest it into the market. market as well, which is the automatic reinvestment mechanism, which is available for index funds, which is also significantly advantageous. Personally, for me, I go more that route, right? So I take more the route of going down the index fund route, just because that is a very useful way. The automatic reinvestment feature is very useful, reinvesting your dividends back into that particular fund. So I'm not going to go too far in this particular video in terms of how ETFs and index funds specifically work. I have a separate video on that. I'll include a link for it up above here, somewhere over here. And then I'll also include it in the end card so you can check that out as well. So one thing that I talked about, right, is this notion of dividend yield. Okay, so dividend yield is basically a financial ratio. What it basically does is it talks about, you know, how much dividends are basically getting issued on an annual basis, and you divide that with the stock price of the company. In the example that I provided earlier, right, what I basically said is, okay, so you can have $4 in annual dividends for that particular stock that was trading at $10 a share, right? So that basically means is that it has a 40% dividend yield. Where it gets a little interesting, right, is, as I mentioned, companies need to maintain their dividend payout, okay? So if they start dropping their or reducing the amount that they're paying in dividends, the stock market does not like it, because they typically believe that, hey, if this company is not going to be issuing this the same amount of dividends on an ongoing basis, or actually growing those dividends on an ongoing basis, it may be representative that the company has some cash flow type of challenges. So companies, they start to stay away from reducing the amount that they're paying out in terms of dividends. What happens there is, so let's just take, for example, a stock. Right, so the stock is basically declining in value for whatever reason. This $10 stock in our example became $8 now. The company is still issuing those, you know, $1 a quarter, right? So $4 a year in terms of dividends, right? So what happens in that particular case is your dividend over the price, right, has actually gone up. It becomes 4 divided by 8 as opposed to 4 divided by 10, right, which basically increases your dividend yield from 40% to 50%. So there is a negative relationship, right, when it comes to stock price and when it comes to dividend yield. As stock prices drop, dividend yields actually go up, and the same is true vice versa. A quick note here, I think it's pretty evident, but a quick note, I'm just using these numbers to make this whole, or to demonstrate a point and to keep this thing fairly simple. You're not going to go out there and you're not going to find stocks that are yielding 40, 50% dividends, right? Let's just be clear on that. If you're finding a stock that's yielding that kind of a dividend yield, there's obviously something wrong, okay? Either the company is running a scam, okay? Or the company is taking all their money and just giving it out and they're not reinvesting it into themselves. So then it becomes a question in terms of how viable is that company going to be, or it potentially is an indicator that they're going to be killing their dividend yield shortly anyway, just because that is not sustainable. You're not going to find companies that basically do that. So, well, you know, what does this mean, right? Does this mean that you just go to Google, right, and then just basically say, hey, highest yielding dividend stocks, right, and just basically start buying them ad nauseum, right, if you wanted to go down the stock route as opposed to going down the ETF or index fund route? Well, the answer to that is no, right? You should not be doing that. When it comes to these dividend yield stocks, you still need to do some level of analysis in terms of what is it that you're buying. Now, I'll be the first to acknowledge, right, that these are bellwether companies, right? These are companies that have been around for a very, very long period of time, and they have been spitting out these dividends on an annual basis, right? So your IBMs, your AT&Ts, your Cokes, they have been issuing that for a very long period of time. But you need to understand what the environment is and how these companies are actually performing, because if you take a different example, right, there's General Electric, right? So GE was a bellwether back in the 90s and even in probably the early 2000s, but then it's just had some very, very tough, difficult times, and it has had to have reductions in dividends and so on and so forth. So it is important to have that level of understanding, right, in terms of, you know, how these dividend yields are actually progressing, and not just make some kind of a spur of the moment decision that, hey, these companies are paying out the highest dividend yields, so I'm just going to go ahead and buy them, right? It's not as simple as that. That's not quite how it works. So let's see, what else do you need to know? Well, one thing that's very important to know as it relates to dividends, right, is there's certain key dates that are very important, okay? So there's really three dates that you should know about. There's a declaration date, the ex-dividend date, and the payment date. The declaration date is exactly what it sounds like. That's where the company basically announces that, hey, we're going to be issuing X amount to our shareholders, right? So that's just basically a declaration, which is fine. The next thing that's more important is the ex-dividend date, right? So the ex-dividend date, what that basically says is that you need to own the stock before a date. If you own the stock prior to that date, you're going to be eligible for the dividend that gets paid. If you buy your stock after that ex-dividend date, you're not going to get paid on that dividend. So that's why this ex-dividend date and having visibility into that is rather important. And then the last thing that you should know about is just the payment date. The payment date is pretty simple. It's exactly what it sounds like, right? It basically says that, hey, we're going to pay out this dividend on this date, and that's the date the money's going to hit your account. The other thing that you should probably know about is just how taxes are handled when it comes to dividends. So there's two types of dividends. There's regular dividends and qualified dividends. When it comes to regular dividends, they are basically going off your ordinary income tax rate, right? And when it comes to qualified dividends, they're typically on capital gains tax rates. So it is important to understand the delineation or the differences between ordinary dividends or your regular dividends as well as your qualified dividends, because the disparity in the tax rate, depending on where you are from an income perspective, can be quite significant, right? So some of the highest income earners, there's only 20% that they're paying on capital gains, but from their ordinary income perspective, you know, they could be paying like 37.5%. So there is significant difference between those two. So it's important to know whether you have an ordinary dividend or a regular dividend, as well as whether it's a qualified dividend. So what are some of the criteria or characteristics of the qualified dividend? So it gets a little dicey, right? But there's basically three specific requirements when it comes to what is construed as a qualified dividend. So obviously the company is domiciled in the United States or one of the affiliated countries associated with the United States, right? Guam, Puerto Rico, etc. They would all fall into this bucket of qualified dividends. The other criteria is basically the IRS has basically said that there's certain types of companies, if they issue dividends, they are not going to be considered a qualified dividend, and they would be considered a regular dividend. So examples of these are basically your REITs, your real estate investment trusts, your master limited partnerships, or your MLPs, employee stock options, and then there's also these tax-exempt companies, right? So these various types of companies which the IRS has said that, hey, they're not going to be eligible for qualified dividends. And then the last thing from a criteria perspective is just basically holding period, in terms of holding period of that associated stock, and that would also have a determination in terms of whether it's a qualified dividend or a regular dividend. The last thing you should probably know when it comes to dividends is that dividends is a form of passive income. So we've talked about that, right? But also that it takes a long time to be able to amass a sufficient number or amount of shares, right? Such that you're actually going to be in a position where you can say, okay, I'm just going to live off these dividends for the foreseeable future. This is where it becomes very important. Like some of those things that I talked about, automatic reinvestments and things like that, they go a long way, right? Because as you get those dividends get paid out and then you keep putting them back into the stock and you keep putting them back into an index fund as an example, over time, that can definitely amass into something more significant, and you get to realize the full benefit as it relates to compound interest in that particular notion. But it does take time, right? So when you're starting out, you know, you'll get some very, very low dividends. Okay, you'll be getting like $4 a month and this and that. You're going to get some significantly low amount when it comes to dividend income. But the main thing to take away from this is don't panic, right? Just keep investing for an extended period of time and you'll be all right. So as an example for myself, right, in the month of December, I've generated over $3,000 in dividend income. And that's not to say that my November amount is the same or my October amount is the same, because as I said, right, these dividends are kind of paid out quarterly. So it depends on where the companies are basically falling in terms of what their cycle of dividend distribution is. But it's a pretty good proxy in terms of how much I can actually generate, right? And I probably have another 20, 25 years ahead of me and before I actually retire. So you can have some perspective that this amount is going to continue to increase, and especially utilizing that automatic reinvestment and the power of compounding, how significant this could potentially be. I mean, you could kind of be in that position where you just retire of dividend income. You're not even touching your principal when it comes to any of your investments. And between that and whatever's left of Social Security, you could be pretty satisfied as you go into retirement. Since I've kind of like talked about how much dividend income I'm generating, right? So probably to give you some perspective in terms of, okay, so what funds do I actually own? You know, I only own four funds, right, when it comes to this particular topic area. And they're all Vanguard related, right? So I have the Vanguard 500 fund. I have a Vanguard Growth Fund. I have a Vanguard Emerging Markets Fund. And then I also have a Vanguard Small Cap Fund. That's it, right? So I hope you enjoyed the contents of this video. If you did, definitely click on the like button and subscribe to the channel as well. I'm always interested in hearing your thoughts and perspectives on this matter as well, right? So if there's anything that you feel like I haven't covered as it relates to dividend investing, include those in the comments below. I'll be sure to cover off those in a future video, or I'll at least respond back to your comments. Thanks for watching the video. I'll see you soon.